Yep. So my company, MDL, creates and distributes original health information primarily over mobile phones. Our very first services were SMS-based, but with the explosion of mobile web and 3G services, we've seen really strong traction in longer form content like articles and especially video. So for perspective, we now every week deliver several thousand video views, over half of which are taking place on mobile on topics such as reproductive health, women's health, sexually transmitted infections, diet, nutrition, etc. I think probably one of the biggest learnings that I've had in this process is that whenever we look at some of those statistics that were highlighted at the very start of this panel around challenges of public health in India, we automatically assume it's solely at the bottom of the pyramid. We go, oh, it's so unfortunate people that don't have no money have suffered from these conditions. When in fact, those parameters that come out from World Health Organization or different organizations are actually much more indicative of tremendous health challenges throughout the pyramid. And so some of the physicians that we work with that help us write our content, I remember one of the doctors said, you know, I see wealthy patients in Bangalore, and I tell them they have diabetes, and the very first question they ask is, well, what pill do I take to cure it? And there is no cure for diabetes. There are very simple things that you can do to help manage that for the rest of your life, but they just don't even know that, and they don't ever really act on that information. So whenever you look at those statistics, again, they're not just solely at the bottom of the pyramid, but much more indicative of tremendous health challenges throughout the pyramid.
Finally, we'll ask Mr. Rajan from IQ to share his
Back in 2006, I was heading surgical business for Washington, and we had a mission of creating eye care revolution for the country. However, we were focusing primarily on metros and mini metros. There was a chance visit to 50 kilometers away from Gurgaon. There's a place called Rewari, which is a 1 lakh population town. Recently, I studied there for 7 years when I was a kid. So when I went there after 15 years, I realized that eye care is what it was 20, 25 years back, and we have failed to create eye care revolution in smaller cities. So however, it looked like a great opportunity to me, primarily because everybody, you know, people were focusing on supply side in bigger cities at that time, but nobody was looking at smaller cities. So it was a contra model, you know, healthcare 2007, I am Ahmedabad graduate getting into it, and that too wanting to do in smaller places. Look like very contra model, primarily because A, the doctors won't go, B, health per se was very unglamorous and very very beaten down sector by private equity at that time. But we thought that might as well try and do it, and if we make successful, I think it will be a great journey. So 2007 we started a group of people, both sides. I had a partner, my partner who's a great ophthalmologist in top 50 of the country. So we got together, and then we also, I could convince a few of my friends who were from my institute, my boss, my senior, and some other people, got them into getting into this venture, you know, emotionally. And they also put money, because that was the thing to get into. And 4 years later, we have 10 hospitals. We could con private equity to put $2 million last year. And we're getting now someone, bigger one, who can invest between $10 and $50 million, depending on where we want them to pitch. So we have 10 hospitals live kicking, and so our focus is primarily to provide world-class eye care at affordable rate. When Gautam met me in the foyer before that, he asked me, are you a no-frill hospital? And I get offended by that, because I think at bottom of the pyramid, you can't afford not to give them those frills and bills. So if we have air-conditioned hospital where a bottom of the pyramid guy comes and we give them free, and we can do that in the cost where the same competitor gives them and still make a lot of money, I think that's the best thing to do. So we are high value hospitals in smaller places which can give price point which is affordable. We can do a great surgery in 3,500, still make money by providing the best technology and still make money for our enterprise and for our investors. That's our business model. Our biggest learning is, I think, I don't agree with ma'am, where she says that we can't take the doctors to smaller places. We have the best of the surgeons going to places like Haldwani, Rewadis, Rohtaks of the world, and stay there. If we get the right insight about the doctor, if we can understand what mindset is he coming from, and whether we can engage him and give him a lifestyle which he wants to take, and apart from that, give him right clinical services. So we have today 25 doctors in 10 hospitals, the brightest of the lot, who do the best of the surgeries. And apart from that, we also have a hub and spoke model wherein we take the best of the doctors from bigger cities. We also appreciate that there are some doctors who are senior and who wouldn't want to move, but they would move in if we give them facilities of good air-conditioned car where they can go once a week to smaller places and provide services there. I provides us that platform primarily because we can accumulate patients and take the doctors to that place where they can have packed machines which they can unpack there and do the surgeries and come back. So our model is very contra, where we feel the doctors can be taken to smaller places and we can create world-class hospitals. Our objective now is to go to 70 hospitals, primarily because we feel that there are investors who are willing to back this kind of a project, and we want to do it in the next 2 to 3 years. So that's our total game plan.
That's great. Okay, very good. So now we'll switch to the second part of this panel, where I'm going to ask a couple of questions.
But if we can create business opportunities in the hinterland, as a scheme like RSBY is, you can actually come up with such hospitals. And when we started this scheme, RSBY, I had not had this in mind. People used to question me that you're putting money in the hands of these people, but they're no hospitals. But it had to begin somewhere. So if you put money in their hands, the initial idea was the handicap of not having money should be taken care of. And probably over a period of time, when that demand gets generated, hospitals will come up. And I was very fascinated when about a year and a half ago, this scheme started about 3 years ago. An entrepreneur came to me and he said, sir, I am putting up a hospital in a back of the Beyond district called Devaria. She would know it, eastern part of UP. And since I had been posted there long ago, in early 80s as subdivision magistrate, so I asked him, why are you setting up this hospital? He said, sir, I have only come to ask your permission. I want this hospital to be named as RSBY Hospital. That's about all. But I asked him why. He said, as I said, you are putting in money in the hands of these people. And if they don't get treatment there, they will go to the adjoining district, Gorakhpur, which is a bigger city, where they will get the treatment. Now, this money is now going into the field. Now, you have to seize this opportunity. You have to find out whether there is business for you. And it has to be a business proposition. You have to look at the fortune lying at the bottom of the pyramid. No CSR. I mean, I don't like this. Because that's not sustainable. Sustainable is a business model. And in the scheme of RSBY, when I went to the planning commission and I told them there are no targets in the scheme, they were asked. Because in government, without target, what do you mean without target? I said, each of the stakeholders has a business proposition. They will do what they ought to do and whom I have to monitor them. There's no term monitor in the scheme. We only facilitate everyone to do what he ought to do because we believe that he will do what he ought to do because he makes business. For example, we pay to the insurance companies on the basis of smart cards that are issued by them, and we have such a tight electronic security system that he can't issue a single card to a wrong person. Of the 23 million smart cards, not even a single card has been issued to a wrong person, making that statement in India is a big statement. Similarly, hospitals will not throw away any patient because that guy is traveling with 30,000 credit in his smart card. So hospital, I don't think you would have ever turned down any patient. Anyone comes to you, will take him. So why should I have a target for you? So we don't have a target. We don't have targets in this scheme. It's just happening. The scheme is on autopilot. The person who's actually, we have a team which does the walking, I do the talking. So a person who does the walking was supposed to be amidst us, but she couldn't come because of some problem. But there is a huge opportunity for guys like you. And there is money in it. But there is only money for your need, not for your greed, because there is a problem in the scheme. If you are greedy, we'll catch you. And she would know. More than 100 hospitals being panelled on the next day. They didn't realize what had hit them. Because every day the information from the hospital comes to a server where it's analyzed through various filters, and next day the team goes there. No insurance has this system. Next day the team is there to check you. So 100 hospitals being panelled. So you are most welcome. Join the family, RSBY.
Right. I know Swaroop is accelerating the process. You're leaving more and more time for tough questions from the audience.
Most welcome.
These guys can slow it down a bit. So next, let's turn to this concept of low-cost hospitals. So, you know, I'm somewhat of an outsider, recently getting more familiar with the healthcare, you know, business in India, but it seems like low-cost hospitals is a model that's going to happen. A lot of energy behind it. You know, you guys are doing it. Investors are putting money behind it. Here are new deals happening. If this is going to happen, who are the winners going to be? I mean, that's where I'd like to get to. You know, what do each of you feel is the special sauce or the thing that's going to make you win or that's necessary to win in this business to get big, to get scale? You want to start, Michelle?
I don't know if there is a special sauce, but definitely there is an opportunity, and there are multiple players that we think will emerge. One is people like us who are targeting the smaller towns. I think the next set of evolution is probably single specialty hospitals, much like ophthalmology. And ophthalmology has a head start on other specialties because the supply of doctors is relatively large compared to other doctors, other specialties. But we are also seeing things like standalone dialysis centers, we are seeing mother and child clinics, we are seeing trauma centers. So there is going to be, we will slowly move away from the large multi-specialty single center concept, both in the urban and the smaller settings, but it's going to benefit the smaller settings more because your cost of setting up a hospital goes down, plus there are alternate financing mechanisms, whether it is through government. And we are also seeing a large number of people budgeting for healthcare. You know, the private insurance sector is important. So we are seeing both from the supply and demand side, there is going to be development. And there is tremendous opportunity. I think we are just scratching the surface.
So what would give Vatsalya the edge?
We just happen to be the first one to start. So, but other than that, there is no edge. And you know, typical Vatsalya type of hospital, Vatsalya type of town, can technically right now hold about 4 players like us. So we just add 20-25% of service.
There's so much space for everyone.
Just to illustrate how significant this is you know, our business is essentially to stop people from going to the next biggest town to get treatment. So when we go to these small towns, there is a small place called Gulbarga in Karnataka. Most of the patients go from there to Sholapur or Hyderabad. The hospitals in Sholapur and Hyderabad operate based on train timings from Gulbarga. So that the OPD, the clinic will open when the train from Gulbarga comes, and he has to make sure all the reports are printed and handed over to the patient before the last train goes. So there's such a significant sort of internal medical travel that needs to be
Rajan, should we pose the same question to you?
I think one critical aspect that I have seen in the last 4 years is that hospital sector hasn't still got the management bandwidth that it should have.